Coming up on The Rock Newman Show, The Green Book was a handy guide to help black travelers safely navigate the Jim Crow South. There's a film by the same name, but there are questions about creative license and historical fact. We'll talk about that and more with my guest, Dr. Wilmer Leon and film critic Tim Gordon. That's coming up on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University right here in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. This evening, we're going to discuss the facts and fallacies in Hollywood's production of The Green Book, a film supposedly focusing on concert pianist Dr. Donald Shirley, but which his family says is wildly inaccurate. We'll analyze the film and also look at other movies like Black Panther, The Hate U Give, and Creed II with author and political scientist Dr. Wilmer Leon. Joining us also is critic and film festival director Tim Gordon. Fellas, thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you.
You know, I'm going to start off with something that might get us all in a little bit of hot water, but I'm going to take that liberty. I'll tell you what I'm talking about in just a second. But Dr. Wilmer Leon, in your writing about The Green Book, your critique of it, you use some quotes from Dr. Manning Marable. And that quote is, "The greatest struggle of any oppressed group in a racist society is the struggle to reclaim collective memory and identity. At the level of culture, racism seeks to deny people of African, American Indian, Asian, and Latino descent, their own voices, histories, and traditions. From the vantage point of racism, black people have no story worth telling that the master narrative woven into the national hierarchy of white prejudice, privilege, and power represents the only legitimate experience worth knowing." That's Manning Marable. You quote from Frantz Fanon's book, Black Skin, White Mask, that the greatest triumph of racism is when black people lose touch with their own culture and identity, seeking to transcend their oppressed condition as the other by becoming something they are not. Now, where I'm going to tread into some hot water here is off subject about these two films, but another matter that I'd like both of you astute gentlemen to speak on. I kind of wish there was a woman here, a female here, but it's not, but I'm still gonna venture down this road. I'm gonna read Frantz Fanon one more time. "The greatest triumph of racism is when black people lose touch with their own culture and identity, seeking to transcend their oppressed condition as the other by becoming something they are not." I recently did a Facebook post, and I talked about being at a high school football game. And I forget the exact number, but I think it was somewhere around 20 females of various ages, from young teenagers to people who were grandmothers, past where I was. And every one of those black females had some form of store-bought
hair. Yeah.
And I wrote that for some reason I was troubled by that. I was troubled by that. When I read part of Dr. Wilmer Leon, your critique from France Fanon, that they try to transcend their oppressed condition by becoming something they are not.
Yes.
As it relates to our sisters, African-American women, and the issue of hair and the proliferation of store-bought hair. Is that what France Fanon is talking about, or am I just...
That's an element of it, but I don't think it's limited to women. I'm counting the NFL players that I see with all of this hair coming out from under their helmets trying to figure out, well, you know, is that your hair? Yes, it is, because I paid for it. We have been conditioned to appreciate an aesthetic, a vision of beauty that is different from our naturals, from our natural aesthetic.
Right.
And it has been marketed to us since we arrived on these shores in 1619. And it seems to be getting worse.
Tim?
I don't know if I can be as eloquent as my colleague here.
None of us can.
But what I will say is the first thing I thought of when you were kind of going through that is I thought about, I would say 70, 80, 90 years ago when you'd have African-American men who would conk their hair back in the day. You know, trying to straighten your hair to make it appear something other than the natural state that it was presented in. I think, let me just finish my point, Rock. I think that we've been taught, we've been conditioned over generations, over centuries, that I don't know what the perfect Malcolm quote is, but literally we almost hate ourselves. And as you said earlier with that quote, that we are trying to transcend
seeking
the condition. We're seeking
someone
to be something else,
right?
To try to meet someone else's standard.
Okay,
I would say that.
And that has that actually, in my estimation, that has everything to do also with these films that we're talking about. You know, when you talk about the conquilines that the brothers sought,
right,
seeking to have another standard of seeking a standard of beauty that again was not germane to us, then came along the beauty and the power of say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud. And then the Afro, the natural.
Right.
And we've seemingly in 2010 and 11 and 12 and 13 and 14, 15 and 16, 17, 18, now 19, gone away from recognizing that there's a natural state of beauty just like you are. And we're going to do a show about that. Well, and let me get into the film. Let me get into the Green Book. You had what could be described, Dr. Leon, as a scathing critique of the Green Book, saying that's their story, this is not our story. And I want to say, and I want to introduce a couple of contrary opinions. The general manager at the station, guy who I'm going to say he ran BET for a good while, his name is Jeffrey Lee. We were having lunch, and I brought this subject up, and I brought your critique up. And he had the position that those people who made the Green Book were telling a story. It wasn't about Dr. Shirley. It was about the driver. It was about someone else. And they had a right to tell that story. And who are we to criticize them for telling the story from their point of view? That's one thing. That's one opposing view. Another opposing view came from Kareem Abdul-Jabbar in yesterday's Hollywood Reporter.
And I love the big fella. He's my number one guy.
One of the things that he said is historical movies are never about history, nor are they meant to be. So let's wrap.
Well, I understand Kareem's point. The problem is that Dr. Donald Shirley actually lived. Dr. Donald Shirley had a life, and the way that his actual story in life was misappropriated to fit a narrative that historically we have been conditioned to believe and understand, or understand and believe, I think is criminal. It's a very good film. I wasn't approaching this as a film critic. I can't do. Mm-hmm. I looked at this as a political scientist, and where does this film fit into the broader narrative mm-hmm. of our story, our history? Mm-hmm. And I believe that they used stereotypes, tropes, why did he have to be born to a single parent mm-hmm. when his father was an Episcopal priest? Yeah. Why did he have to be born in poverty when he was actually born upper middle class?
Correct.
Why did he have to be disassociated from the black community? Because the stereotype is, in order to be successful in this country, mm-hmm. you can't have that Afro. You can't be natural. You can't be connected to who you are. Mm-hmm. You have to have assimilated and accommodated in order to be successful in this country.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
The real story of Dr. Donald Shirley is so much more powerful, is so much more empowering than the foolishness that they put on the screen, that the movie would have been 1,000 times better had they told the real story. But in my opinion, and I would like to get your take on this, mm-hmm. had they told the real story, then it would have had to been marketed as a black film. And being marketed as a black film, it would not have made nearly the money that it made, because they had to play to the sensitivities from a marketing perspective of the predominant white audience that most movies are written for.
Having been an executive at BET, Jeffrey Lee was very conscious of the dollars and cents, and that if it don't make dollars,
it don't make sense.
Don't make sense.
And Tim, your response.
Well, this is interesting, listening to Dr. Leon, because I approach films and I see on average about 300 of them a year. So I'm looking at a film for exactly what it is, about, you know, how it's cast, how the story evolves, looking at a lot of different factors. So I'm not, when I watch these films, the first thing I thought of when you were discussing your mm-hmm. take on the film is, I remember years ago being with a group of reporters and we were interviewing Spike Lee. Mm-hmm. And people were complaining to Spike that, you know, hey, your movie's in Brooklyn, it doesn't have these drugs, it didn't have this stereotype, it didn't have that. And Spike said, you know, you can make your own movie. Just because I made my movie, you can make your movie. And mm-hmm. I sort of feel that way a lot of times around the controversy with many of these films, including this film. Now, I will say that when I initially reviewed the film, yeah. I gave the film an A. Mm-hmm. Because it's a crowd pleaser, it's mm-hmm. entertaining, mm-hmm. but it was after I took a week or two to kind of step back from it mm-hmm. that I started thinking about the one thing that troubled me, and it was the perspective of the film. And I kept saying to
people, what do you mean by that?
The perspective is that it's told through Viggo Mortensen's character, Tony mm-hmm. Lip, the white character, mm-hmm. about the African-American character. Mm-hmm. And I think to me that's the most troubling aspect of it, because in a year where you have a Black Panther, a Black Klansman, If Beale Street Can Talk, and right. so many other stories that are told from our perspective, mm-hmm. this film to me feels, the perspective feels tone deaf. It feels like a movie that's out of the 1990s, out of the 1980s, mm-hmm. when you talk about movies like Cry Freedom, mm-hmm. Driving Miss Daisy. Mm-hmm. It feels like the type of story that Hollywood shouldn't be making in 2018 or now to tell us about our history, when there's so many African-American directors and storytellers who can present our stories in our voice. Yeah. And I think that's essentially, so I agree with you, even though I don't agree totally about films having to be that factual, because mm-hmm. I think there is a certain creative license that all films
have. There would be a natural rub between the way you guys might analyze the film, because you're a social scientist. And you're a film critic.
Correct.
Okay, so that's a natural, right. there would be right. a natural rub there. Let me tell you something, Dr. Leon. When I read your analysis, mm-hmm. what what I thought your analysis did, and I'm going to recommend everybody find it, Dr. Wilmer Leon talking about the Green Book. What I thought it did was it so adroitly articulated the history of Hollywood's propensity to elevate characters from the dominant population, from the white population.
Correct.
And to categorically, systematically diminish the humanity of others. So when I read your critique before I saw the film. So as you wrote this, was that your mindset? Was your mindset that Hollywood once again is lifting up the uneducated bouncer who punches people in the face and diminishing this? First of all, let's establish this for anybody who hadn't seen the film. Don Shirley was one impressive human being.
Absolutely.
He was a child prodigy. They found that out at 2 years old. By the time he was 6, 8, 9 years old, he was studying at some elaborate conservatory. He went on to get 3 PhDs and became fluent in 8 different languages. Wow. So you are talking about an intellectual, entertaining giant. And you had so much to celebrate and to lift up. And
you did none of that. You did none of that.
So my question is, were you thinking about Hollywood's history when you did that? Or
yes.
Were you just focused on this film?
To me, I couldn't separate the two. Mm-hmm. That's why I wrote in the piece that the movie is formulaic. It plays to typical tropes about the African American community. And let me give you an example. Have you seen the film about Ruth Bader Ginsburg?
All right, be talking about On the Basis of Sex.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Do you
not necessarily a good film though?
Do you think that they would have portrayed Ruth Bader Ginsburg as an alcoholic? Do you think they would have portrayed Ruth Bader Ginsburg as a lesbian? Do you think they would have portrayed Ruth Bader Ginsburg as having to be introduced into about the concept of equal justice under law, mm-hmm, by some black janitor named Leroy Washington in the basement of her law school, that she was walking around aimlessly about the concept of equal justice under law, and she happened to bump into this black janitor named Leroy Washington who introduced her to the concept along with matzo ball soup and bagels?
Okay.
I doubt seriously that they would take those liberties with Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg.
Yeah.
Why take them with Dr. Don Shirley?
Well, let me jump in by saying that what you're saying goes to the heart of the history of our the portrayal of African Americans
right
in Hollywood. So,
and that's why I say it's formulaic.
Let's go through it. Mm-hmm. So we are introduced in 1910. It's the Pullman. Pullman is our first film, right? 4 years later, D.W. Griffin introduces us in a way, even though it's supposed to be us, but it's whites and blackface and the birth of a nation.
Yeah.
That film kind of lays the groundwork for the next century of how we portrayed. So the whole time you're talking about what's happening in Green Book, I'm flashing in my mind watching films like Hallelujah in 1929, mm-hmm, you know, Step and Fetchin' in the mid-30s, or Rex Ingram in some of these films.
TV shows.
Little Rascal. So
Buckwheat.
Correct. So the issues that we're talking about are over 100 years, and that we're slowly trying to like a Titanic going down. We're trying to turn this huge liner around before it crashes. But this is, I mean, you're spot on. I would agree that I didn't give it that much thought, but everything you're saying is actually spot on. But I think it comes from more of a historical place than where we're starting today. We're starting looking at this film now.
But during that 100-year span of time, we had Canada Lee.
Yeah, but you got to remember that there's a huge, the big issue when you're talking about film, though, and our portrayals, mm-hmm, is that for the longest time, we didn't fund our stories, right?
Understood.
So whenever somebody else is telling your story, hence Green Book, this story is being told from Peter Farrelly, who did Dumb and Dumber, right?
Right.
So this is his his film that he's directed. The story is written by Tony Vallelonga's son, Tony Lips.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it puts his father in the best light, and it doesn't look at Don Shirley's story.
Yeah.
Don Shirley is a supporting character in this film. We don't see, his life isn't three-dimensional. We don't know anything about his family in this film other than the aspect that we see on
screen. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar says that this was a passion film. And had it not been for the passion of the son,
mm-hmm.
that it is quite likely that this film would have never gotten made. Now, I'm going to tell you something. I'm embarrassed to say it, but I had never heard of Don Shirley.
Neither had I.
I had never heard of Don Shirley until this film got made.
The only reason I had heard of Don Shirley is because my father was a jazz aficionado.
Yeah.
My parents were deep into music.
Yeah.
And so we have Don Shirley music in our collection.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's the only way that I had known.
You can go and give it up to yourself. You're a jazz aficionado. I listen to your radio show all the time on Sirius FM.
So to make him, well, it, not only was it a passion film, it's a feel-good film.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Because everybody that I've talked to that has seen the film, oh, it's a beautiful movie,
right.
And it is.
Yeah.
It makes you feel
so good. It's a beautiful movie,
and
but
it
it's
does.
Not a factual movie. And I think there you
And on Facebook, a sister said to me, I've seen it twice. And I said, great, you saw a lie twice.
Yeah.
And here's the thing. Why? See, I've been in close contact with the family. I am not going to try to portray that I am speaking for them because I am not.
Right.
But I do speak to them regularly.
Mm-hmm.
The family is insulted. The family is utterly insulted. They're not looking for money. They're not looking for fame. Their life story, their brother, their brother-in-law, their Uncle Donald has been portrayed as an utter fool. And they are frustrated at the fact that their reality has been made out to be, as Mr. Maurice Shirley, his youngest brother, said to me, why would a white man have to introduce us to eating fried chicken? We were PKs, preacher's kids. We knew all about fried chicken. It flew past our plate every Sunday. It's those types of things that just make you scream when you know the reality of the family.
So let me tell you, after I did not see the movie until after I read your critique.
Mm-hmm.
So I went in the theater with my fist balled up. Like, there they go again. And at the end of the movie, you're right. It was a feel-good movie.
Mm-hmm.
It was a feel-good movie. There was a coming together. There was a learning of, there was an example of a learning of each other's culture.
Mm-hmm.
There were stereotypes for days.
Right.
With the Italian-American Goomba
mm-hmm.
guy, you know, that whole mindset in the Brooklyn apartment. And Kareem Abdul-Jabbar talks about how the Lips' options were seriously limited
mm-hmm.
by his poverty and his family's lack of education. So you agree that it was a feel good movie.
I do, but I want to backtrack for a second because I keep hearing you talk about factual, right?
Mm-hmm.
10 years ago, before I start my story, I cut my teeth here on campus at Howard, producing at HUR for years, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I remember a decade ago, a movie called Talk to Me came out.
Mm-hmm. Peter Green and Dewey Hughes. Mm-hmm.
Bingo. Now, without getting in too much trouble, let's just say that there's a gentleman.
We make news on the Rock Newman Show, so go on and go for it.
There's a gentleman still working at HUR whose father was portrayed in this film, and he was incensed at what he watched when he watched Talk to Me. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, I didn't know the story because I'm not a native Washingtonian. I've lived mm-hmm. here 35 years, but mm-hmm. he was insulted that his father's role in the film, Sonny Jim Kelsey, mm-hmm. was minimized while Petey Green's role was elevated. And he went on to explain to me and was hot mm-hmm. about that film. So when we talk about films being factual, remember earlier.
Let me just say something.
Go for it.
Because I'm D.C.
Go for it. Talk
I'm
to me.
I'm
talk
D.C. To me. Through and through.
I'm listening to you, Rock.
You know, I got mumbo sauce running through my veins.
Go ahead, Rock.
So I love Sonny Jim Kelsey.
Right.
As I think he was the disc jockey, mm-hmm. and he might have done some program directing.
Right.
But Sonny Jim wasn't no Petey Green. There's a whole nother category right there. I love Sonny Jim Kelsey.
No, but I'm not saying that Petey Green deserved the movie. I give him that.
Yeah.
But I think what he talked about was the way his father, he felt, was minimized. Uh-huh. And again, when you talk about passion projects,
yeah.
when people are close to a subject, I mean, these are the sorts of things
Absolutely.
That come out.
Yeah.
So that's my point.
Just for some historical accuracy, mm-hmm. and Lord knows if the brother is watching.
Right.
Please, there's no disrespect intended.
Right.
But I didn't go to Sonny Jim Kelsey's funeral, or I wasn't aware of it.
Right.
I'm going to suspect that for Sonny Jim Kelsey's funeral, there might have been 100 or a couple hundred people. For Petey Green, there was 10,000. It was the biggest funeral in the history of Washington, D.C. So I'm just saying, but I get your point, though. Here's someone, family, personally offended by a movie that was fairly well received. Your point.
I think this also needs to be discussed a little deeper in the context that you started out with the broader historical context. Mm-hmm. Because I think we have to look at Edward.
Not for the movie, but for the movie industry.
For the movie industry and part of the role where this film is in a continuum of movies.
Okay.
In that Edward Bernays, who was Sigmund Freud's nephew, and was heralded as the father of public relations in this country. Mm-hmm. He developed the concepts of the manipulation of the American mind using news, film, uh-huh. and other media sources.
Uh-huh.
And let me quote him if I could. The conscious and intelligent manipulation of the organized habits and opinions of the masses is an important element in democratic society. Mm. Those who manipulate this unseen mechanism of society constitute an invisible government, which is the true ruling power of our country.
Ooh, you're going deep, brother. You're going deep.
So Edward Bernays developed this whole, he's the one he started this campaign in 1929 with Lucky Strike cigarettes to get women to be allowed to smoke in public. Mm-hmm. There are so many things that he did using news and using movies. Diamonds are a girl's best friend.
Right.
The whole idea of making diamonds, people believing that diamonds are rare and valuable when actually they are not. The whole De Beers campaign, mm-hmm. all of these things, that's why I say the movie is formulaic and it plays to the stereotypes. Why did he have to be born to an unwed mother?
Yeah.
Why? Because that's the story that people accept about us. And we also need to talk about the insult that it does to the Green Book itself.
Yeah, on that, I don't think we can move talking about that with it talking about basically what the point was. Also, he was an alcoholic in the movie because every night
I'm watching the movie, mm-hmm. and when they say he needs a fifth of Cutty Sark,
yeah.
which is nasty scotch to begin with,
yeah.
but a fifth of Cutty Sark. every night in his room, yeah. I sent a text to his niece, Carol.
Yeah.
Was your uncle an alcoholic?
Right.
She wrote back, no, he was not an alcoholic, and he never would have drunk Cutty Sark.
Yeah.
He drank Pinch.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. He was highbrow now.
So wait a minute, Rockstar. Yeah. I guess I think from what I'm listening to, because again, you heard me say in my opening that I don't really go into the historical aspect of movies.
Yeah.
I'm watching a movie for what it is.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. So there's two things that
explain to me, please. Sure. Share with me, help me, and help the audience.
Uh-huh.
You say you go into a movie for
what it is.
What does that mean?
Okay, an example. I went to see Glass last night, which was the third part of the M. Night Shyamalan trilogy, Unbreakable, Split, and now this film, right?
Okay.
So when I say I go into a movie for what it is, you present me a story, and a lot of times I don't even want to see a trailer. I just want to go in with no expectation. Mm-hmm. I want to watch your story. Mm-hmm. I want to see how it's cast, how it's scored,
uh-huh.
how it's acted,
uh-huh.
how the scenes progress, how it plays out, yeah. how emotionally it makes me feel,
yeah.
Whether I think the story is plausible. Sometimes, a lot of times, the story is not, and I go, oh, this thing is stupid.
Mm-hmm.
Or you've got a good concept, and you don't execute it properly, so all that goes into the phrase, I watch it for what it is.
Right.
So when I went in to go see Green Book, Green Book is a story about Dr. Don Shirley. I'm not going to research who Dr. Don Shirley is.
Mm-hmm.
I want to watch this movie first,
mm-hmm.
find out what it is.
Mm-hmm.
So I watched the film, and I automatically went in with the attitude that it looked like Driving Miss Daisy, right?
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
So I said, okay, well, let me see how this plays out. So I watch it. And of course, we've got the racist Italian who early in the film, you know, you've got black workers at your house. He takes
the glasses,
puts them in the garbage can.
Mm-hmm.
The wife takes it out. So the film is showing you that the wife is a little more tolerant than the husband is.
That's right.
Of course, he's racist. He doesn't want to drive for a black man. We see Dr. Don Shirley portrayed with regal bearing.
Yeah.
And here he is with this guy. I'm about to go on tour. So we watch all of this play out. We see their friendship, which is the typical Hollywood kind of buddy comedy, you know.
Yeah, buddy
we
film.
Start off Dumb with and differences, yeah. and then suddenly, somewhere along the line, both of us have some challenges or an epiphany.
Mm-hmm,
and then by the end of the film, you're able to come to my house for Christmas, and my family welcomes you in,
right.
when earlier that would not have happened.
Right.
So saying all
day.
That to say,
yeah.
So my point was, is when I initially watched it, I saw it at a film festival. So, film again, that's another issue that films play different in that environment than they do in a mainstream theater. So the movie plays well at a festival, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm thinking about the film, and to this day, I haven't seen Green Book again. I watched it that one time, and I haven't seen it since.
Okay.
That it has been on my mind thinking about it, and I was like, what? There was something about this movie that troubled me, and then I started thinking, and I said, it's the perspective. So I had one of my best friends ask me, well, how would the perspective have been different? You know, give me an example. I said, well, I'm not a screenwriter, but I'm just thinking that the perspective needs, the story needs to come through this character, not about this character. If we're doing the Rock
story
Newman,
the story needs to come through
the character.
Don Shirley.
Right, so if we're doing an autobiography of you, right, we don't need to have a story where somebody on set is telling the Rock Newman story and you're in your own story, but not a participant, that it's not coming from your voice.
Uh-huh.
It needed to come through his perspective. I was interested in finding out more about Dr. Don Shirley. Give me a three-dimensional look. What is his backstory? Who is it? Who are his parents?
So I got I have a question for both of you.
Right.
Of course, that is what we would prefer.
Right.
If that story was told from that perspective,
right,
and it made 10 or 20% of what it's going to make being told from the lips perspective,
mm-hmm.
what do we do?
Why can't the movie be the same movie, but when Tony Lip
Are you talking to me or are you talking to Hollywood?
I'm talking to you.
Okay.
I'm talking to Hollywood.
Uh-huh.
Why can't the movie be the same movie? But when Tony Lip turns around and asks Don Shirley about his family, why can't the answer be, oh, well, my father was an Episcopal priest. I'm very close to my family. Instead of
now, is that just rhetorical or do you want an answer?
I want an answer.
Okay, so here's how I would respond to that. And Kareem Abdul-Jabbar responded similarly. That the black experience is one where when you go into this movie, you're no less impressed with Dr. Shirley or more impressed as a result of what you see being told in this particular story. But the white population that is going to patronize this movie, they come to the movie
with stereotypes.
They enjoy the movie, mm-hmm. and they go right. out and they talk about the movie.
Hence my saying it had to be made in terms, it could, if you had focused on Don Shirley mm-hmm. and the brilliance of his family and their accomplishments.
Which would have been a black story.
It would have been a black story.
That's well, right. See, but
wait a minute, but that's why I prefaced my question with keep the movie as it was. Or keep the movie is.
I disagree.
No, wait.
I think you can't keep the movie as it is because the story, the way it's designed now, is designed to be marketed a certain way.
No, I understand
so
that.
So I get that.
But my point is
hold it.
No, but I was going
to
say.
To be marketed a certain way.
It's to be marketed for mainstream consumption.
Right.
And it was released during award season, so the studio, I forget the studio that released Green Book, but they're mounting an Oscar campaign because
right.
they're trying to make this a prestige film.
I understand.
Yeah. So that's the purpose. But what I was going to say is that you could have taken this screenplay without losing the economic impact of it. You have any number of African-American screenwriters or directors that could have written this story. Mahershala Ali is an Oscar winner
right.
who could have still played Dr. Don Shirley. And with a different perspective, it coming through him telling a more factual story, that's a different movie. That's not to say that it's not the same movie.
I understand.
But you can make another movie about the story.
So to your point,
right?
Ali,
yep,
apologized to the Shirley family.
He has.
Yeah, he has.
Yes,
he has.
Well, they
called him up because they said that the movie was a symphony of lies,
and
he called them and had to.
And he told the family that he was told they did not exist.
Right, and that was the other point that I was going to make, because you keep talking about all the historical inaccuracies. I want to know, Peter Farrelly and Tony Lip, did they actually even know or care to do the research on Dr. Don Shirley to even figure out what his family situation or his background was?
Tony Lip's son, well, I don't know the answer to that question.
Apparently not.
Tony Lip's son
right.
knew they existed. Because they interacted, Tony Lip's son knows the family.
So it's a conscious decision then on his
part.
It was definitely a conscious decision for him to change that. So I didn't know.
I want to go back to Ali for a second. I want to go to who played Don Shirley.
Right. Mm-hmm.
How difficult, that is such a crystallization of how difficult it is to be a black man in America.
And right, in Hollywood.
Because no white character would ever go back and apologize to any. No. I mean, it's
well,
true.
See, that's another point. Why can't Viggo Mortensen, why can't they just admit, and this is so.
Well, Viggo Mortensen. He wouldn't do it. But I'm saying the guy who wrote the screenplay, Tony Vallelonga Jr.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Would be the guy who should go to the Shirley family
Here's another thing. It insults the Green Book, because in the film, every place where Dr. Shirley's character stays
yes.
is a dump.
Is a dump.
Is an utter dump in the worst part of town.
And so in essence, this is also good, and I didn't mean to cut you off, Dr. Leon. First of all, the movie's called Green Book.
Right.
The only reference to the Green Book is when Tony Lip has yes, the book
right.
and has to find places for Dr. Don Shirley to stay. And to your point, because I remember asking this question, because, you know, I'm too young to have been in the
yeah.
Green Book era, but,
yeah.
like, it made it look like every community throughout that he had to travel, like you said, looked like a dump or was somewhere in the hood.
And I'm balling my fists up again.
The Lorraine Motel where Dr. King was assassinated yeah. was not a dump.
Was in the Green Book?
No. Yes. Okay. Was in the Green Book and was not a dump.
Yeah.
So what it does is and I'm sure if we were to ask the writers of the film, they would say, well, we wanted to show the disparities. between where Tony Lip could stay and the realities of segregation in America. Mm-hmm. But you had thriving businesses. You had black hotel owners that ran very nice establishments. Mm-hmm. And that gets no recognition in the film.
See, what it, again, I can't really disagree with Dr. Leon on that
And that's a diminution mm-hmm. of the black experience.
Correct.
And that's what this film is.
But this speaks to what I told you earlier about who tells our
stories. Right.
If you tell your story, you're going to tell it with a little more sensitivity than how the other race will tell your story.
The greatest struggle of any oppressed group in a racist society is the struggle to reclaim collective memory and identity.
100 years of this. 100 years we've been going through this struggle.
I asked Dr. Leon if he had seen Beale Street because I did something I've never done in my life.
Did you cry?
I'm not a movie guy.
Okay.
I saw The Green Book and then went right across the hall. I paid for that second ticket and saw Beale Street.
Right.
You saw Beale Street.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things I put on Facebook when I came out was, oh my God, what a beautiful love story.
Oh, absolutely.
But it was painful and sad. And then I quoted Baldwin.
Absolutely.
To be relatively conscious
is to be
in the United States
is to be in a rage.
Is to nearly always be in a rage.
Right. Yep.
Your feedback on
Beale
Street.
My feedback on this film is that Barry Jenkins, who won the Oscar for Moonlight and also did a film called Medicine for Melancholy, has something that I call the Jenkins aesthetic, right? All his films usually have a thread of romance or love that runs through them.
Mm-hmm.
He usually always has films that are beautifully photographed. If you go watch If Beale Street Can Talk, it's a beautiful movie to watch.
Yeah.
And then he always usually casts an unknown actor, which to me makes the story feel a little more authentic because it's not like I'm watching Will Smith
or
Denzel Washington. I'm watching this person I don't know.
Yeah.
So this feels like this is like a story.
Yeah.
It's a slow. It's a very slow film.
But the slowness never loses you.
It never loses you, and it's a love story, which is showing African Americans in love, which we don't get a lot of, and again, told from a perspective of someone who is of African American descent, in Barry Jenkins, using James Baldwin's rich source material.
Yeah.
But it is sad. Because it sort of reminds you, or to me, what I took away from it is that our struggle in this country as it relates to law enforcement never ends.
Yeah.
That, you know, just when we feel like we're taking one step forward, films like that show that, you know, we're taking two steps back.
Uh-huh.
And this family's love of trying to exonerate this innocent man for this crime.
Yeah.
Regina King is great in this film.
Oh, my God.
And she's going to win the Oscar.
Hey, you know
for
what?
This film.
Hollywood defenders would say, hey, we don't just diminish you, the African American community, because that cop was an absolute degenerate.
Correct.
And so one would say, you're stereotyping a New York cop, and therefore you're stereotyping all cops.
Mm-hmm.
And you would say?
I would say almost that it's almost like when you talk about stereotypes and these tropes that, again, now we're behind the camera, and now we get to paint the story or tell the story in our perspective. So much like you get the stereotypes in a Green Book, when it's a white director telling the story about a black man, you get a similar or reverse situation when it's a black director telling a story about a white cop.
Mm-hmm. That speaks to the question of power.
Correct.
It speaks to the question of power, but it also speaks to the question of volume. In what I mean by that is
they're releasing way more films than we are.
There you go.
Oh, I know exactly where he's going with this.
So because they're releasing way more films, they have a lot broader canvas upon which to paint. They have a lot more space in which to operate. It takes me back to when Do the Right Thing came out. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people were complaining about Spike Lee and that film.
Right.
And one of the things that I said about the film was, well, unfortunately, at this point, Spike is pretty much who we have. He's all we've got.
Right.
And so he has to be everything to everybody.
But in 2018, let's be fair, of all the years in Hollywood history, this is by far
the
biggest year
for
African Americans. Okay. Five films directed by African Americans. Yeah.
This is such a fascinating subject. I'm gonna mess around and get past where I want to go because I need both of you all to talk to me about the Black Panther.
Okay, what do you need to know?
What I need to know is was that a good film for Black folks?
Oh, I think it was a fantastic film for African Americans.
It was a groundbreaking film for Black folks, and not just from what appeared on screen. Uh-huh. Black Panther showed the power. Well, there's a couple of things about Black Panther. Black Panther showed the power of the African American dollar because African Americans went and saw that film 5 to 8 times. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've talked to people who saw that film 7, 8 times.
Yeah.
The reason why it resonated so much is for years we've always talked about we descend from kings and queens.
Yeah.
And this is the first time that you gave an African-American not the first time because F. Gary Gray has done these Fast and Furious movies that have had a $200 million budget, but you've given Ryan Coogler a $200 million budget.
Right.
He brings in Ruthie Carter, who creates the fashions and kind of the look, the production design of Black Panther. It's a film visually.
It puts a Howard University graduate in the lead role.
Let's not forget Chadwick Boseman at
Howard University.
In the lead performance. And you have a movie. Now there's still some racism involved. And we're going to get to that in a second. There's a film that made $700 million, the highest grossing domestic film of the year. Mm. But the racism and what bothered me about it is if you study Marvel Cinematic Universe, right? So I think they've released 21 movies since 2008. Black Panther is the first and only film, and I might be wrong on only, but I know it's the first film in a long time that made more of its money domestically than it did internationally. Mm-hmm. Because remember, mm-hmm. we represent 35% of the world. The rest of the world represents 65%.
Yeah, yeah.
So when the film played over in China, we heard it was too black.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Chinese folks said, oh my God. Mm-hmm. If Black Panther had followed the economic model of the majority of the films in the MCU, mm-hmm. that film should have made 1.7, 1.8 because most of those films make 40 to 45% here, 55, 60% overseas.
Yeah.
Black Panther made 52% here, 48%. Mm-hmm. So those were the numbers that I was looking at.
Did you hear any numbers at all from Africa?
I heard numbers from Africa. And I was disappointed at the numbers that I heard initially at the initial box office. I don't know where the numbers finished, but Black Panther made probably, I think it made $700 million. So it made like maybe $640 overseas or something like that. Okay. But that's the other 65% of the
that's
world.
That's crazy. That's
so
crazy.
That number should have far
exceeded America. What that speaks to is the potential that actually Hollywood is not really exploiting what could be the potential of the black movie dollar.
No, they can't get out of their own way. They are blinded by their racism to their own economic interest. Mm-hmm. And they are so much more comfortable.
At the expense of their own economic interest.
At the expense of their own economic interest.
Mm-hmm.
They are so comfortable in their own perceptions and stereotypes and tropes.
Yeah.
And the stereotype about us, what we want, what we're interested in, what we will actually pay to see.
Yeah.
They just don't get it. They just don't get it.
So my producer wants me to ask you about The Hate U Give. I don't know if either of you
seen
that.
Oh yeah, I saw it.
I have not seen
it.
I'm a film critic, I've seen everything.
Okay, all right.
The Hate U Give is another important film. That literally kind of speaks to, I like to use the phrase, ripped from the headlines. Uh-huh. You know, basically a story of a young woman living between two worlds, living in the hood, but being bused to a school, a much better school.
Mm-hmm.
She has an alternate life. She is, as they call it, code switching. She speaks one way for them.
Yeah,
she speaks one way to us.
Yeah.
She has a childhood friend who is senselessly killed by a police officer, and it's sort of like a switch. Clicks her to kind of step into her level of activism. Mm-hmm. And in stepping into her level of activism, it makes the people in one world, the white world, kind of uncomfortable with her because now she's found her consciousness.
Yeah.
And she's ready to speak out on the injustice that she witnesses in the world.
Yeah.
But there were some great supporting performances in this film from the person who played her father, Russell Hornsby.
Yeah.
Really
so
good
story.
So
let me ask both of you from your perspectives mm-hmm. about this. Which black actor was it a couple of years ago said, I am not going to dress up in drag, I'm not going to put on a dress, and then, Dave Chappelle.
Right.
And so then he articulated something that, you know, wasn't necessarily in my consciousness, but then he went through the various actors, Martin Lawrence, and so
Wesley
many
Snipes,
others,
Eddie
who,
Murphy,
who had put on a dress, who had put on a wig, who had cross-dressed and all the rest. From each of you, what's Hollywood's fascination with putting black men, effeminizing black men?
It's a matter of power, and it's a matter of minimizing power, and it's a matter of co-opting the strength of the African-American man.
Film critic.
I was going to say, we've had white actors that have done it as well. They had a film called Tu Wong Fu, so they put John Leguizamo, and I'm trying to remember who the white actor was that was in it as well. But to your point, I see more African-American men having to go down this route, and I've always often wondered why. Look at Tyler Perry. Now, I understand in Tyler Perry's point, because again, I go back to economics. Mm-hmm. You look at Tyler Perry's films with Madea, yeah. those films averaged $10 million more dollars yeah. than the non-Madea films.
Yeah.
So in Tyler
yeah,
Perry's
yeah.
mind,
yeah, yeah.
he's a businessman too.
Yeah.
I'm trying to make money.
All money ain't good money.
You know what,
here's what I'm going to say. I don't think one can blame Hollywood for Madea. That's Tyler Perry.
Right, that's Tyler Perry doing Tyler
yeah,
Perry.
That's Tyler Perry. For whatever you think about it, right or wrong. You know,
right.
I'm one of the local gentlemen here. The columnist for the Washington Post. He slams Tyler Perry all the time for the Madea role, but that appears to be one that you just cannot blame Hollywood for.
No. Yeah, but I've seen it so much, and I've often wondered why. What is the appeal? And I would agree with you, Dr. Leon, that it is power. I mean, you know, that you minimize a person by. You know, like if somebody told you to put a dress on, it would minimize you as a human being, or at least that's my impression.
Whew.
And I've seen
that's
so many.
That's not a good visual.
That visual.
I've seen so many black actors go down that road, man. And I'm like, whoa.
Got any moo-moos?
But all money's not good money,
all
man. You're right about that
money.
Part.
And why do they feel that they have to do that?
Well, but I think there's pressure that's put on them. Just like Dave Chappelle told the story,
yeah.
that it wasn't even written into the screenplay, mm-hmm. and the guy just had a dress and a wig in his mm-hmm. in his dress room. Mm-hmm. He went, "No, I'm not putting that on."
Yeah.
And they kept sending people back, you know, "Come on, Dave, it's going to be funny," and
yeah.
"I'm not putting that on."
That's my point.
Right.
Dave didn't put it on.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So Rocky, Sylvester Stallone, tell you a quick story. Mm-hmm. Sylvester Stallone went to Don King back in the 70s. And asked DK for $50,000, and he was going to make him 50% partner in the franchise of the Rocky films. Mm. That was his vision. DK damn near threw him out of the office. It still lives. Creed 2.
Mm-hmm. Creed 2 is absolutely fantastic. You know, the continuation of the story, Stephen Caple steps into the director's chair, Ryan Coogler, of course, doing Black Panther,
yeah.
so he couldn't do this sequel. I just thought the evolution of this story, you know, which actually speaks to when we talk about Green Book, Creed 2 and Black Panther are two really good examples that you can have a protagonist and an antagonist. Mm. You can have them both in the film and make them both three-dimensional. So we see Victor Drago, who's the opponent that Creed has to fight. Mm. We see his backstory, his motivation. His mother left him. His father is there. Mm. He's fighting for the pride of Russia.
Yeah.
And then, of course, we get the backstory that continues with Creed. That you know, he's now as a child. Mm. He and Bianca, I forget her name, Tessa Thompson. They're getting together. The whole backstory there. So there is
a
way.
And you think Donald Trump was rooting for the Russian?
Well, yes, he was.
So look. I've got 2 minutes. I got 2 minutes to get out.
Yes.
So,
sir,
your best film ever, Best movie ever, your favorite, number one, pick a number one, and why?
Godfather 1 and 2.
God, he took mine, man, that's mine.
Why?
Just incredible story, tells an incredible history and a reality of America. And I think it's just a fabulous film. The social dynamics and the relational dynamics within that film are so practical and real. Mm-hmm. I can't tell you how many times I've seen that film.
So that was yours also?
I would say Godfather. I think Godfather 2 is better than 1. And I think it's better because it's both a sequel and a prequel that kind of has two concurrent stories running that all are brought together. Mm-hmm. He's absolutely right. I mean, I wrote an essay 15 years ago that this was the film, the quintessential American film. Mm-hmm. It's an amazing film, well told. Almost no wasted scenes in any of these Godfather films.
I was going to say Pootie Tang, but then I decided,
guys,
to stick with
Godfather. Guys, thank you so very much for joining me today, both of you. Thank you, Dr.
Rob, it was a pleasure,
okay,
man.
Okay, thank you. Folks, that's our show for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye, and may God bless you.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.